on the previous slide on this slide. So welcome again, everybody. Today's presentation will be handled by Dr. Jason Myers. He is going to talk about occasional invaders for with us this afternoon, particularly spotted lanternfly, which I know for many of you can pose a unique challenge. And as a little bit of a surprise bonus for you that have been able to join the call with us this afternoon, we will have a drawing after the call for three prizes. One sort of grand prize winner, if you will receive a backpack sprayer, and two of you will receive a half-gallon Yeti jug. So those names will be drawn and sent out after the fact, after this call. We won't be doing it live. They'll be sent out after in an email, which will also contain the recording for this call. So looking forward to Dr. Jason's talk. But first, for those of you who haven't had the opportunity to join us for one of our Perimeter Pro webinars over the past couple of years, I just kind of wanted to tee up some context. What exactly is Perimeter Pro, and what can you expect to gain out of the talk today? Or if you decide to go back and rewatch some of the previously recorded webinars, what can you hope to gain from those? So the Perimeter Pro playbook really has three foundational pillars. Those are around committing to an integrated pest management strategy, choosing the right starting rotation based on seasonality, pest pressure, whatever unique situation you might be facing, and then building a what we call a bullpen of trusted specialists. So those are the products that are really rock stars in especially tough situations. It might be a little bit more specialized than those that you use, in your sort of your regular rotation. Can go to the next slide, Jason. Fingers crossed that it advances. Nice. So what do we at BASF see as our starting rotation and our bullpen products? So the starting rotation are going to be those tried and true solutions that many of you are familiar with: the Terminator SC, Alpine WSG, Fendona CS. Really our flagship dilutable products, each which serve a distinct, a distinct puzzle piece in those unique challenges that you face regularly. But in those specialized situations, right, where I mentioned you might want a more specialized or targeted approach, we do call out some specific players in our bullpen here. Those that are highlighted, I'm in marketing. I'd be remiss if I didn't touch on the fact that our October promo is going on now. So in addition to some of the, Terminator family and termite baiting opportunities that come about this time of year on promo. We also have some great bullpen players as well that you have the opportunity to take advantage of for the month of October. So those are highlighted: the Terminator foam, PT Fendona, and PT Alpine pressurized, among others, are on promo this month. And with that, Jason, we can go to the next slide where I give a comprehensive overview of the featured products on promo. So I mentioned many of our termite solutions, right? Whether you're baiting, whether you're liquid, whether you're both, in addition to our Terminator foam solution to complement those liquid and baiting options nicely. And then on the more general insect control side, we're happy to provide our WSG, our Fendona CS, but also some pressurized solutions, right? That PT Alpine, PT Alpine flea and bed bug, PT Fendona, and then Salantra, our flagship rodenticide here, cholecalciferol-based rodenticide, which is a fantastic option for those of you interested in a non-anticoagulant rodenticide option. And then, of course, Old Faithful, right? Instant soap. Instant soap has a place in everybody's truck and everybody's van. It's a great option to use when water and soap aren't readily, when water isn't readily available. It's ready to go. So with that, the next slide is just a little bit of housekeeping. If you have a question that pops up while Jason's presenting, please use the Q&A tool. A few of you are already using that to ask, why the heck aren't we starting on time? So please just go back to that and drop your question in there, and we'll take some time at the end to answer those with Jason. So that's all from me. With that, Jason, I will hand it over to you, sir, and take it away.
Awesome. Thank you. Hey, on the subject of professional sports, our beginning of our presentations handled a lot like the Dodgers the last couple of nights. They have not done so well. All right, so we are going to be discussing occasional pests. We'll kind of get into some occasional invaders versus perimeter pests, and we'll kind of get into that information. And then we will discuss some specific pests and some of the newer pieces of research that are involved with it. So here's the lineup for today. And looks like the slides are rolling beautifully now. I don't know what in the world was the issue before, but everything seems to be going just fine. So we're going to discuss occasional pests in general, and also kind of a little bit of a miniature overview, but not too much on perimeter pest control, because so much of what we do for occasional pests involves a lot of perimeter pest application behaviors. And then we'll get into kind of some of the late summer, early fall pests, and kind of depending on your definition of when they really come out. Springtails is kind of one of those that becomes kind of one of those all year round issues, depending on what situation you've got. So, what is an overwintering pest? Because we're about getting ready to have a lot of this type of behavior come upon our industry. So, it is considered an adult arthropod, which can pass through some portion of its life cycle within the structure and then survive winter conditions in some way. Basically, it means that they're just going to be sitting put, doing much of nothing. And then on warm days, they're going to bug the ever-living heck out of the homeowners until they call you and have you come out and give you exponential amounts of money to get rid of the problem. So typically, they're found outdoors for most of their lives. And at some point, some weather aspect is going to change, whether that be cold nights, rainy, cold periods, or dry periods. Eventually, they're going to find their way into the home, depending on what species we're talking about and what time of year and all the other factors that are involved from an environmental standpoint. They're going to invade typically temporarily, but some of them are going to overwinter completely. Those that move in and out of the structure are going to be some of the more problematic because they're going to be most likely to be seen by the homeowner. Otherwise, they're just going to be coming out and they're going to sometimes come out into the wrong areas, which are going to bug people once they start flying around, like ladybugs and the like, right? They're looking for mainly shelter, typically not always going after food and water, but they can, depending on what species we're talking about. Here's a list of the major groups. So we could be dealing with some sort of arachnid, whether we're talking about spiders, mites, ticks, you name it. We've been in the Midwest, we've had lots and lots of issues with mites lately, and PMPs all over the place having serious trouble controlling them consistently. And so I kind of foresee that becoming an issue again next year as well. So be on the lookout for all sorts of mites, not just the typical ones. Okay. Scorpions, depending on where you're at within the country, millipedes can be popping up at some point, centipedes, and all these other oddball oddity pests as well. Those that are associated typically more with soil, Turkestan roaches, which are now kind of scattered quite a bit all over several states now instead of just a couple. Crickets, earwigs, ground beetles, and the other normals, spiders and springtails. Those that are in vegetation that might come indoors, certain types of spiders, although typically not talking about the garden spider that's on the right, but it can be all sorts of different plant bugs. In fact, a plant bug is one that we're going to end up focusing on here in a little bit with the spotted lanternfly. Typically, they're not too big of an issue, and they're usually associated with interior scapes of some sort. But now with spotted lanternfly, that's and brown marmorated stink bugs, it's not the case anymore, right? Then there are some types of ants that are considered kind of a pack ant, if you will, like pack rats in a way, and that they're going to be taking advantage of certain situations, and moving here and there, and moving their colonies here and there, and they can become occasional problematics as opposed to more consistent ones. Invaders that fly, you got plant bugs again, and then you've got our typical paper wasps, cluster flies, and the like. Thankfully, some of these pests will come out very consistently, year in and year out, so you can potentially predict some of these behaviors so that we can put out preventative applications, as with the case of cluster flies. So, what are we going to be doing physically to either prevent or eliminate or control these populations? You'll be looking at exclusion, insecticide applications, physical removal. We'll use all of our tools of the trade to do each of these principal methods. So, when we take a look at perimeter treatments in general, we're going to try and address issues at the point of entry, typically. But we can also look at it as a holistic standard where we're looking at household issues and the surrounding areas. You know, maybe we've got houses that are too close together. Maybe we need to put together a potential neighborhood program where if we can get enough customers in here on the clientele list, then it makes our job a heck of a lot easier, right? Then we can go in to look at vegetation and say, hey, you know, you probably need to trim your bushes back, and hopefully the homeowner listens to you. You know, sometimes we can make our job a little bit easier. And then sometimes we need to look at efficiency of use of product. You know, are we using too much product? Do we need to become more efficient in our behaviors? And also ease of scheduling. A lot of these overwintering pests are going to be clustered into these really small areas and even neighborhoods. And if we can be efficient with our scheduling and our time allotted to these, you know, we can really make a big bang for a buck and increase efficiencies and profitability for the company with occasional pests. Okay, so typically we think of these as we can quite often predict when these are going to come out year to year. Depends on, you know, hey, you know, maybe in this region of the US it was really warm and dry. And so maybe it's going to impact by 2 or 3 weeks some of these pests that are going to be coming out in either which direction, you know, maybe 2 weeks before or 2 weeks after the typical occasional pest activity. But if we can put out preventative type applications, we know we can have some form of residual available to us on certain surfaces, then we can really avoid a lot of the potential callbacks and put people on preventative programs, which is really advantageous as opposed to something that is reactive. So we can sell something ahead of time to hopefully prevent, especially if those customers have been tracked and you know that they have previously had issues with XYZ occasional pests. Okay. Tons of different active ingredients out there for all sorts of different perimeter applications. We've got a lot of choices as an industry. You know, a lot of this surrounds pyrethroid use. And, you know, what we found with some of these newer pests is that we can't always be reliant upon pyrethroid applications, as we
Hey,
will see
Jason.
with the spotted lanternfly. Yes, Zach.
Would you mind advancing one more time and then going back to this slide? It's looking like it's like half transitioned.
Interesting. Okay.
I don't know if any. There it was. Yes.
There it is. That is very interesting.
Yeah, it's happened on a few slides too, but
Okay.
they end up coming through. But that one I
Okay.
know. With the list of actives, it's important to be able to see them. So
Okay. Thank you.
I'll try to give you a heads
All
up
right.
if it happens again.
Yeah. Thank you. Okay, so typically in these perimeter treatments, we can get to the point where we've done this so often that we end up not thinking about what we're doing, and we end up doing the same exact thing every time. And maybe not every structure is going to need the same type of behavior or applications. Maybe we need to switch to a different product for a particular reason. You know, we've got a completely different pest. Hey, you know what? We need to avoid this type of group of insecticides, right? There's a number of things that we would like for you to look out for and not become these zombie sprayers that just go out and do things accordingly, according to what you did previously, right? So we want to think and be adaptive to the circumstances and the pests that we might be switching to. All right, and there's a picture of Zach on Friday when he's tired of the week of work. Perimeter
Guilty.
pests. Yeah. Perimeter pests. Hey, what are they? So they're typically the primary target that you're going after, right? So we think of these as ants and roaches, even spiders. Spiders are kind of one of those kind of a gray area where, yeah, it can be considered a perimeter pest. And then you got some species that are totally occasional, and they're going to be coming into structures periodically throughout the year. But think of these as more consistent targets that you can go after that are going to be more natural recurring revenue for pest control companies. They can do damage or harm, whether that be nuisance type activity, but oftentimes they can create some sort of physical damage to the structure, right? They can complete their life cycle inside. Right, they're fully capable of it if you don't catch them in enough time, and the control techniques are very specific to that particular pest. Whereas occasional invaders are typically the secondary target, and of course, by name, they are an occasional target, or sometimes or rarely are they going to be doing damage or harm. They don't complete their life cycle indoors, they at best are going to complete part of it, right? And then the control techniques tend to be more general in nature, and there are some examples there at the bottom, right? So we're going to work ourselves into more specificity with the upcoming species. So first off, we're going to talk about springtails. Springtails have been on the tips of the tongue of a number of the members of our industry, and so we're going to get into a little bit more in depth on springtails and the problems that they create. And it's really, honestly, it's not the problems that they create, it's the problems that the environment creates for insecticides and the behaviors of individual technicians in response to the invasion of the springtails. So quite often we find them in basements, bathrooms, kitchens, anywhere there is typically a water source. But there can be other oddities, it could be garages and the like. It all depends on the external environment away from the structure and underneath it that can induce some of these springtails populations from come to come into the structure. So a lot of times they'll follow pipes and moisture associated with it. And sometimes these can be really, really subtle, right? So we're not always bringing plants in and then suddenly seeing springtails pop. These can very easily follow pipes that you would not normally think of as following. So we've got to pay really close attention to bathtubs and the like, and pipes that might be going into the structure, because at some point, environments are going to dry out for them, and they're going to need some sort of access to liquid in some way, shape, or form. Organic debris and mold associated with that organic debris are typically the biggest reasons that we've got springtails moving into these structures. And that is what we need to focus on, as opposed to always focusing on the pest itself. So if we can eliminate some of that and get the homeowners to agree to do something about it, it's extremely helpful. Sometimes it's associated with new construction because maybe they change something within the dynamics of the home itself, and you've got suddenly a new doorway, if you will, for springtails to come into the structure. Sometimes we have interior scapes. People right now are bringing plants in or starting to bring plants into the home. Some of those are going to have springtails associated with them or earwigs or whatever. But when we bring those in, we need to start asking questions this time of year. When we can't quite figure out exactly where the springtails are coming in at, we need to start asking questions of the homeowners and communicate. The more we communicate, the better off we're going to be in trying to eliminate or control most of these large populations. This is a purely aesthetic pest. Now, however, they have been known to cause dermatitis at times where this is one of those rare ones where you think people might be trying to make you think that you're crazy for thinking that they're crazy. But sometimes you will end up with springtails on people's person and they can react negatively and create this itching sensation or almost like a almost a pain type situation where the hairs will cause this kind of somewhat extreme reaction for the individual person. Okay. Springtime, they'll come out. Again, depends on whether or not you've got mold associated with it. But you can see them any time of the year. It's just that most of the time we're going to be, beginning to talk about it in the springtime. But nonetheless. Okay. The major thing I want to talk about here, let me get my pointer. And we're going to talk about this furca here. Okay. This furca is that device that they use to attach into this coliform. This coliform can then, at a moment's notice, release kind of like fleas do, right? But this got this basically a massive rubber band all throughout this structure that helps them launch themselves into the air, which is why if you get any close to them, they're going to be jumping around, which is what some of these people are going to notice. They're like, oh my gosh, I must have fleas or something else, whatever, who knows? Whatever imaginary pest homeowners are going to think of. Remember, just because they might be saying fleas does not mean that they have fleas. It could be springtails, could be some other oddball pest that they think that they've got, right? So what are we going to do for management? We're going to try and get rid of the mold, damp sources, and the like. I've got this example here. This was out in Arizona, where everything looks nice and dry, but then when you start digging into some of these grades, and you start realizing, wow, there is actually quite a bit of moisture here, right? Way more so than you would think. And you notice this little electrical box right here, this pump that's in here, is actually going to elucidate some mold growth, right? So we've got mold growth inside this box, and then right next to here, inside this garage, we've found tons of springtails entering into the system. And of course, we have stucco too, which is problematic for a number of different reasons. And yeah, the grade looks pretty decent, but nonetheless, they were still getting into the structure. We could be talking about a break within the slab quite easily. There's any number of different things that you need to start looking at alongside where we have potential mold growth. Right here, we have a great example. Yeah, you know what? It's not 4 inches away, but it's not too shabby. But what are the chances of this homeowner actually moving this grade to move this a few inches lower? It's slim and none. They're not going to spend a boatload of money moving all this soil and creating a new grade away from the structure to potentially avoid springtail issues. And then you think about, okay, what are they going to put on top of here? Well, I'm probably going to put like 4 inches of mulch on top of here. And guess what's going to be right up to these windows, right? And so anytime you might end up with an excessive amount of moisture associated with mulch and the like, then you could have the serious potential of springtails moving into a structure. this is a good example where we've got a good sizable grade away from the structure. However, we're dealing with these window wells, and look at the mulch. The mulch is right up against this, and this could be causing some sort of issue where they're moving into the structure, and you could have some other oddity pest that might be moving in. We also want to pay close attention to drip lines, right? So drip lines are nice, and typically we can ignore a lot of this type of placement, but some of these areas that are lower are going to be collecting water, and you know, if they had some sort of drainage apparatus that's clogged up, that could be causing some sort of mold growth issues, and through pipes they could be moving into the structure, right? So what else are we going to do? Ask the homeowner to use dehumidifiers, reduce the overall moisture level within the environment to try and prevent the springtails from coming in. And if they do come in, they're going to dry out relatively quickly, which is going to help out your any sort of additional efforts that you're going to have, like insecticide use and the like, right? It's just going to do nothing but help. It's certainly not going to hurt. Allow the potted plants to dry between watering. So if you communicate that with the homeowner, and then along the outside perimeter and sometimes on the inside, we're going to be using some sort of dilutable within and outside the structures. Okay, once they get indoors, typically they're going to be dying out pretty quickly. Your job is to try and prevent them from coming into the house if you can. If they do enter into the house, and for whatever reason are surviving for longer periods than they should, you're going to look at moisture levels within the environment or underneath the slab. So start paying attention to those. So what type of dilutables could we be looking at? This was a test that we did a number of years ago that looked at Alpine WSG. And you can see here that Alpine WSG controls springtails really quite quickly. And it's, you know, they're going to notice a difference very quickly. All right. So, you know, this was done at 0.1%. However, the label calls for the 0.3% usage for springtails. So know that very little material needs to be brought upon them in order for them to succumb to it. In fact, we had, you know, you can think about it in a similar study where we did an Alpine roach bait test. And we glued the mouth parts shut of these German roaches, or some of them, right? So like on the right, you can see here, big giant glue spot that covered their mouth so they could not eat the bait. And then you have others that were able to eat the bait. And you look at the mortality that's associated with it. And those that were in contact, those that had their mouths glued shut, and those that were able to ingest, there was not much of a difference in the mortality rates, right? So, you know, 3 days out, you're looking at basically almost identical results. So all they needed to do was touch the material or touch the dinotefuran in order to succumb via mortality. Okay, so what are the key takeaways for Alpine in general? You know, we've got reduced risk status through the EPA. It's non-repellent. And we test that on all sorts of different surfaces to demonstrate that non-repellency and across a wide spectrum of different pests that we've looked at for non-repellency. So, you know, it's a really fine, the WSG lineup is really fine lineup for these occasional invaders. And in fact, I really have not found any of these occasional invaders, even the big bodied occasional invaders, like we'll talk about with spotted lanternfly, that do not succumb to the Alpine WSG. The other thing to keep in mind is the nature of the actual formulation itself. Alpine WSG is considered a true solution, all right? So that means it goes into solution and it stays in solution. You'll notice on the label, it does mention to agitate. Now, do you need to agitate at the same rate? You know, not nearly as often because, you know, look at this. This is 30 days out and it is not settled out of solution. Whereas you can look at Some of these others, competitive ones, where the material eventually can dissipate and settle down at the bottom, right? So, it kind of depends on which formulations you're talking about. The other aspect is with occasional invaders, you're going to be looking at a wide variety of different surfaces to interact with. And this particular video shows the high rate usage of Alpine WSG on really dark surfaces. And when you look at it, once it's allowed to mostly dry, you still don't see any sort of what could be perceived as staining. And we've even looked at windows and the like, and it dries out clear. So just like when you place it into your BNG and the like, it's coming out clear. And on those surfaces, it also comes out clear. So the the potential for staining is excessively low compared to many of the others. And in fact, I haven't found in particular, I have not found a surface that it has stained yet. So maybe we have a challenge out there. Find something. Okay, spiders. All right, so we're going to talk about spiders. A lot of people still have difficulties with spiders. Oftentimes, quite frankly, it depends on what region of the US you're in and what cluster of spider species. Because some products work exceptionally well in some regions, and then others, the same product might not work nearly as well within a different region. And that has to do with the collection of species that you're dealing with, right? And their behavior based on that and their metabolisms and such. So there's a wide variety of reactions. So you need to find something that's suitable for your region. But I'll give you something to think about here in a few minutes here. Most spiders, beneficial, right? And then some of these few selective ones are the problematic ones that are around structures, right? So obviously we're talking about arachnids, right? And spiders are within the order of Araneae, and they're gonna, for the most part, they're gonna live for most of a year, okay? And their life cycle is gonna be try to be completed within that 1 year time frame. And some of them will live for more than a year. Yeah, tarantulas we don't really need to worry about unless you're in a specific region of the U.S. But the one over the majority of the U.S. that people still have to deal with inside of homes is brown recluse spiders. Those suckers can live for years and become really problematic. We'll talk about that here in a little bit. But the females, typically for all spiders, are going to live longer than the males. They found with tarantulas, they have really high metabolism in males. So, they just don't typically live nearly as long as the females do. All right, so morphology. First up is the cephalothorax. It's a combination of a head and a thorax jammed together because, you know what? Hey, we need some variety in biology, I guess. Then we got the abdomen. And then we've got the scary, so-called scary pedipalps, which typically people think about as being the nasty parts of the spider. But in fact, more often than not, they're not doing anything other than holding their prey. But where the damage is done is with the fangs, and the fangs are shooting in venom into their victims, whether that be, Zach in his bed at night, or whether we're talking about some sort of insect that's jumped into a web, right? So eye patterns can be very useful for identification. We've done a couple printings of the BSF Spider Identification Guide, which is done by Jerry Wagner. It's excellent, excellent job. Makes it really quite simple to try and identify spiders so that you can potentially identify what type of behavior and where they're typically going to be around a given structure if you can see if capture a few of them. Vision, not that important for the web builders, but it is incredibly important for those that hunt. And it also depends on where you're going to be around a given structure, and then are they likely to move inside of a structure, or are they going to stay outside and just be a problem creating webs around the structure? So you can see here all these different eye patterns and the like, and you start to see, oh, okay, I think this is where George Lucas may have cheated and made like half of his characters within Star Wars, because I'm pretty sure I've seen like half of these things in all of his movies. They're nasty, ugly looking things. Okay, so behaviors of some of these spiders. They have tremendous sensory capabilities with their feet, all right? And they have very, very pointed feet if necessary, okay? So they can sit up on their tippy toes and they can avoid some particular applications of products, okay? And we'll kind of get into that here in a little bit. But more often than not, biologically speaking, they're going to be using that to catch prey in some way, shape, or form, because they can feel so much of everything. And then, of course, as a predator, they can hang on to their prey much more easily. Spinnerets. Spinnerets are really cool little apparatuses which have a variety of different usages. They can be used to obviously wrap prey, like here in this particular picture. And it is made of proteins. In fact, the US military has even looked in to try and duplicate some of the trying to recreate mass quantities of webbing, because it's some of the strongest substance on the face of the earth by weight and by diameter. Some of this stuff is really cool technology that the spiders have created. And you can see here in this particular picture, you can see that there's a number of different glands that are created to create an individual piece and strand of webbing that might go into it. And you can see on the right again, they can almost put out like this fan spray, if you will, of webbing, which is more useful in certain situations. All right, so what type of spiders are we generally talking about? Typically, we're looking at web versus hunters, right? Web builders are going to stay put, or maybe they'll build a web and then stay in the corner, or maybe they'll build these huge fanciful webs that we see down in the lower right, or some that are maybe disjointed webs like the cellar spider that we'll talk about here. And then up top, we've got wolf spiders, tarantulas, jumping spiders, and the like. Typically, those are going to be the hunters. They're going to be moving around, or maybe they're going to stay put in one spot and then jump out and get you, because, hey, it's Halloween time. Cellar spiders. They are going to be these long, slender spiders, typically going to be found in basements. They're going to be creating these rafter webbings. They're going to be all over the place. The reason that they all over the place is because they build and rebuild and rebuild on top of old nests and beside old nests. And so these, huge nests look like, oh my gosh, I've got tons of spiders. But in fact, I've really only got like, one or two in a particular area. And that's because they just build and rebuild their webs over and over again and interconnect them. Right, brown recluse. Marked by this violin shape on the back of the cephalothorax. Okay. And so anytime you see that, you've got yourself a brown recluse, whether it be Western brown recluse or whatever, right? Some common names: fiddler, fiddleback, violin, brown spider. But the biggest problem is that they create these necrotic wounds associated with their bites, and it just over time, if nothing is done about it, it can create a pretty serious wound where it just eats away at the flesh. Typically speaking, doctors, if they can recognize it, not all of them can, because not all of them are trained in bug bites in general. But if they can recognize it, they'll typically give you some sort of steroid, which will help your system typically get rid of the chemical that's causing the necrosis. Black widows typically going to be hiding inside of something. So anytime we're looking at rodent stations and the like, we're paying high attention and being on high alert for black widow usage. In fact, some people are using insecticides inside some of the rodent stations that are out there, and it's really important to watch out for. So these are typically a neurotoxin, not typically, they are a neurotoxin, and when it does affect people, it can affect the whole body. So we're talking about a systemic reaction of some sort. But those can be also quite painful because they're irritating the nerves quite readily within the bite area and sometimes systematically. Brown widows, so somewhat similar, right? Except that they're going to be obviously dun-dun-dun brown, right? No secret here. They can be kind of all sorts of different type of colors, black, white, yellow, orange, brown, whatever. But they have that typical hourglass, red hourglass shape within the females. All right, yellow sac spider. This is one where it's an example where it likes to kind of almost make a combination effect where you're building a spider or building a web, and then they're going to jump out of it and race out and catch something. This one is responsible for probably more bite reports than any other spider in the US, and we don't often talk about it. So, probably rather get bit by this than a brown recluse, but who knows? I don't know. It depends on how you react. All right, so told you I was going to throw you a little bit of a curveball. We're going to talk about Termidor for spiders. It's not something we talk about very often. We've done a few studies out in the field, and frankly, we should probably do some more because we get some really good results with Termidor against spiders. So all those areas that we need to treat spiders on the structure are there within the label, under eaves, penetrations. You name it, all those areas that we really need to use against spiders, we can use the Termidor. It's perfectly allowed, right? Spiders, right there on the list. We list out black widows, brown recluse, cellar, hobo. Doesn't necessarily mean it won't work on the other spiders, right? Like I said, check this out because regionally, some places are going to work better than others. So I'm going to show you a field study that was done with Termidor SC, and it was done in a commercial facility in two different areas, two different sites, and looked at whatever web spinning spider was on the underside of the eaves. So this is conducted by Dr. Nichols out of state of Florida. And you can see here the typical sections that were treated with Termidor or in control areas. And you look at this alpha site. So we're going to talk about alpha site and a beta site. And these are pictures of the pretest. And then they're going to track them over time, see if they increase over time or if they decrease, right? And here are the results. So we can see here, alpha site up here. And then we go down to the alpha control where nothing was used. Then the beta site, which Termidor was used. Beta control where nothing was used. So we have the pre-counts, right? And then we knock off the webbing and treat, and then we start to look at numbers over time. And the controls, you see, okay, we knocked them down because we knocked down the spiders. And then they start to come back. By day 30, we've got threefold increase in spiders, and then a fourfolding or three, another more threefold increase. And then we get a fivefold increase by day 90. Okay. And then the beta site, we knock down the spider webs. And then we've got a 5x here, or 6x here, and then we got a 12x, and then we have an I don't know, I can't do math all of a sudden, and then we've got huge disparity here, and again another huge disparity, so very large disparities if we go out 90 days, so we got to control a great deal of these spiders with Termidor. Or we can have these populations build up over time. But, we talk about spider control. My goodness, Termidor is actually quite good. And we look at the cleanliness at 30 days out of this alpha site. We look at the beta site 60 days out. And you're looking at a really clean surface, which obviously homeowners and businesses are going to be happy with. So we've also got Fendona CS, which can be used on, we've done tons of different spider studies with them out in the field and in the laboratory, and it's an extremely effective product on spiders. So it's another one to consider for different regions within the U.S. So one thing to think about, when you start to have a sense that, these populations are kind of staying put, and I'm not seeing very much effect with the products that I'm using. Some of this can be because of the behaviors that spiders will create, in which they will basically stand up on their tippy toes. Then you can see barely these little claws on the end of their tarsi, and they can stand up on the tops of those, and they can avoid certain applications. So if a surface seems too hot for them, and they could be reacting to that, and they could be sitting up off their on their toes, avoiding some of these applications. So we need to maybe switch it up to some sort of other spider product. We've got, Phantom SC is really a good, really good spider product. Some people absolutely swear by it. And of course, that's considered a non-repellent. It's not a pyrethroid. So if you switch up and you've got a spider infestation that really only needs crack and crevice type applications, you can utilize that for spiders. So just something to think about whenever spiders are starting to react to some of your applications. Start thinking about that. Okay, so here's a close-up view of the tips of the claws on the end of the tarsi. All right, moving on to spotted lanternfly. It is a pretty new scourge that has started again in Pennsylvania. I don't know what the deal is with Pennsylvania, other than that Philadelphia seems to bring in new pests from Asia for whatever reason quite readily into their port. I don't know what's going on there, but it is something to behold, because the numbers with the spotted lanternfly can be outrageous. So sometimes you'll see us refer to it as SLF, spotted lanternfly, even though lanternfly is one word. Okay. Originally, they're found in Pennsylvania. They spread fairly quickly. All right. So this is the 2020 area, in which areas or counties within these five states or so. And you can see it moved into even Northern Virginia, New Jersey quite readily. And since then, it has moved on a pretty good ways, and I'll talk about that here in a second. But it came over from Asia, okay, and in some of the colder climates, so it's used to colder climates. However, whenever you release a new pest into a new environment, you really don't know how they're going to react. So they may end up moving more southward than we think, because they are free from whatever microbes or predators that were attacking them in the first place in their native areas in Asia, right? And so they've suddenly become released from them. And so, they may end up doing some different behaviors than what we're used to. So, the farther south you go, the more you need to probably pay attention to it, because you're also more likely to have the potential for having multiple generations within a season. Right now in Pennsylvania area and the like, in the similar latitudes, you're talking about one generation per year. But if you start moving south, the higher likelihood it is that they may eke out a second generation within a year. And then you're dealing with it, as a kind of a more seasonal pest than just a one time a year pest. So here it is currently in 2023. Since these maps have come out, it has moved much more readily into Virginia. It's moved officially into Ohio, Illinois, and then there was a brand new one that Nick Iverson just told me about, and I'm just completely blanking on it now. And maybe he can type it into the question areas, but at any rate, That's a bummer. I can't believe I blanked on that one. Anyhow, so it's moved into some of these other areas. So we're going to see them, and they're official, and they were, living strong in populations in both Illinois and Ohio. And the likelihood of controlling them at this point is, incredibly unlikely. So you're going to start seeing them move further westward. All right. So what's their life stages look like physically? The egg mass, which you'll see on the left, not all of them are that grayish material. Some of them have, there's kind of all sorts of different colors, kind of as it changes the age. It probably, frankly, changes what they eat. These egg masses can produce quite a huge number. And the egg masses themselves are really problematic for control, which we'll talk about here in the next few slides. Early nymph are all black with dotted, white dots. And then they move into a few molts into that color state or color type. And then a late nymph, they'll start turning that reddish color. Okay. And as an adult, with the wings over them, you can see the reddish pink coming through. And then when their wings are spread out, then you can see them red more readily within the hind wings. Okay, so the adults are going to be the adult females are going to be laying eggs, ovipositing egg masses, typically onto tree trunks, onto tree limbs, onto other stuff. Could be a motorhome. Who knows? But there's all sorts of different things, but primarily you can be looking at trees for the egg masses. Then within that time frame, they overwinter as an egg mass, and then they hatch in the April June time frame, again depending on weather. And then they move into second instar, third instar, fourth instar, and then they'll become adults anywhere from about July to December. And they can live throughout this time period, and then they'll start to obviously die off. So what other things does it affect? All sorts of agriculture, ornamental plants issues, specific to Pennsylvania, huge issue in the grape industry. They're really, really concerned about it, and it is negatively impacting the grape industry. But there are all sorts of other nuisance issues. But man, there's a wide variety of different agricultural plants that they will land on and harm, begin to harm. So the good thing is that they don't bite or sting. They don't seem to kill trees and plants, but their numbers are pretty sizable in some areas. So they can be, they can create some serious stress to trees. And resulting damage due to the stress, just because of the penetration into the plant, and then the plant has to defend itself from, the potential microbes getting into the plant via the proboscis of the spotted lanternfly. Right now, they talk about scraping down, destroying the egg masses, which you see over here on the left. We'll talk about some sprays that you can potentially use. They're doing bands, like glue trap type bands on trees, but that only works partially. And in some situations, those can get covered up really quickly. They'll remove preferred hosts, like the tree of heaven is the most preferred host in landscape areas for homeowners and the like. And then they're using insecticides. Some pyrethroids can kind of work, but Pennsylvania Extension has had its greatest success with neonicotinoids. Okay, so actually did a test with some common outdoor surfaces with spotted lanternfly through the Penn State Extension group, and looked at the high rate of WSG because, quite frankly, these are larger bodied insects. And typically speaking, they're going to need a little bit more product in order to control some of these larger bodied insects, kind of like what you'd see with American cockroaches, right? So what are the results? You spray on vinyl siding. We've got pretty good efficacy out to a week on vinyl siding for adults. And we switch over to the late instar or the third and fourth instars. And we can get out potentially two weeks. And if we look at this product, may or may not be a BSF product, who knows? We will typically see with these larger bodied insects like brown marmorated stink bug, we had very similar results on vinyl siding and similar type sidings where we can get out a week or two or maybe 3 weeks, and then efficacy starts to wane. But that does offer us a potential time period where we can be predictively looking forward to preventative applications if we can time it to a couple weeks out. And we can gain some pretty good success on these large-bodied insects. Then we look at Tree of Heaven. So we actually applied to Tree of Heaven and then look at the results over time. And you can see here we get 3 weeks with 90-plus percent control, and then the efficacy starts to wane at 4 weeks out on the fourth instar. And again, another set where we did a fourth instar nymph over time, and we can get out again pretty consistently 3 weeks out here for pretty good control. And so that at least offers you some time to get some leeway to have the potential for preventing some of these issues, which of course gets clientele on the books for you. So what are a general take home? So Alpine WSG, very solid control out 2 weeks. This is right in line with what we've seen with some of our other products, including Alpine WSG and brown marmorated stink bug. So very similar, and like we've said, it can have some problems with some of these perithroid materials with some of these larger bodied insects. The high rate seems to be better than the two products, Dinotefuran, it backs up what Penn State Extension said before we even started this study, was that they found Dinotefuran to be one of the best, if not the best, product out there for SLF control. Data addition that we've got for this that we just saw is certainly enough for label addition. We'll be talking to some states about seeing if we can add this to the label so we can kind of move this forward, hopefully for next year. And then where other states where, where it does, this pest does not have to be listed, we have those sites quite often on the label already. Okay, so you can move forward with it and utilize it as is. However, in some of those states where we've got where the listed pest is necessary, you're going to need to wait till we get those printed labels out into sales. Okay. All right. So, what are some recommendations? Lawn licensing can be very useful. They're not always going to stick to the boles of trees or the trunks of trees. All right. So, our pest control licenses, depending on the state, typically go out to the bole or the trunk of the tree, and then you're limited thereafter. So having some sort of other license that covers more broadly some of the landscape plants away from the structure or the trees can be very useful. Appropriately labeled products, need to use those and understand your state laws relative to that. Typically, normal or higher volumes are going to be appropriate because, these are larger bodied insects, and you're going to need more extra oomph in order to get the returns on the benefits of your efforts. So keep that in mind as well. Treatment on outdoor structures and then in infested tree boles. You'll see them in porches, some sidings, but more often than not, they're going to become some sort of landscape type issue. Hopefully, future studies by Penn State, Virginia Tech is also looking at it, but more from a ornamental and fruit extension uses. But Penn State's starting to realize that structural is also an avenue that they need to pay close attention to as well. So hopefully we'll have some more additional information coming from them. Dr. Tefferon seemed to be the most consistent based off of what they said and then what we found as well. So we looked at it and, Alpine WSG can work on numerous different life stages of SLF. Some permits are required within Pennsylvania. So if you're in Pennsylvania, please look into that a little more extensively. Biosecurity is going to be a biosecurity issue for any of these states that it moves into, and whether or not some of these states are going to have, laws that that prevent people from moving infested materials. We're going to have to wait and see. But that's going to be interesting to see all this pan out. Something else that was looked at, Pennsylvania State looked at egg masses and treating them directly. They'd had some serious issues with penetrating the egg masses with typical dilutables. They use all sorts of dilutables, stuff that are dilutables that are not even within our industry, more on the landscape side and ornamental side. And even they utilize some of the insecticides that are available for us in dilutable form, meaning within our industry. And they really didn't find any success. So a couple things that they did find success with, which is a couple of different aerosols. There's not enough data to run with it as yet, but if you have these sites on the labels, you can actually utilize, or if the egg masses are on sites within the labels, you can potentially be using this to elucidate some pretty good control. Both of these products had 95%+ control of the hatching individuals, whereas there was another couple of aerosols that they utilized that did not get nearly that amount of mortality associated with it. So something else to think about relative to where the egg masses are being ovipositored. All right, and with that, I will leave you with the stewardship slide. So please read and follow the label directions. If you have any questions on those, you can always call us. We'd rather have a preventative call than a reactive call, just like you would, right? So please keep that in mind. And we will entertain any questions that you may have.
Awesome. Thank you, Dr. Jason. It's funny, Nick Iverson texted me and said that Tennessee has confirmed spotted lanternfly specifically in the Nashville area. Yeah, so.
Thank you. Thanks, Nick.
Yeah, absolutely. Circling back on that point. And then I just personally want to circle back on a point. I'll just reiterate, thank you everyone for attending. Thank you for your patience during kind of our initial technical difficulties. Glad we got those resolved. And then earlier I had shown a slide on the BSF fall promotion featured products. I just wanted to mention a little asterisk there that certainly those products can vary on state, specifically for those of you in California and New York might have a slightly different lineup just based on state availability of those products. But I just wanted to mention that now because I forgot to mention it initially. We do have a couple of questions. The first is a question on the spider eye chart. Is that available in a print format version, Jason? I don't know. I know we mentioned a spider identification chart. I don't know if we maintain a digital copy of that on our side.
That's a nice question. It's a fine question. And Lisa might actually be able to answer that one. I don't know.
Thank you, Jason. We do not have this. Okay. Do you think someone else in the industry or one of the publications might have something available like that?
It may. I mean, it's within the spider identification guide on individual pages, but mm-hmm. there's not a overall page that shows all of the different patterns.
Oh, there's also a
Thomas
comment.
Shahan is the yeah. artist of the spy turn. There you go. Yeah.
Yeah. So.
Yep. So you might be able to find that on the internet.
There was a question regarding alpine cockroach gel baits, Dr. Yeah. Jason. So this question hits on a perception that rotation two has been noticed to be more effective than rotation one. This audience member asks, is there any truth to that, being that they are the same active ingredient dinotefuran?
Yeah, so, you know, we've got, there's the potential for them for a perception difference based off of the contents of the food matrix, or the, you know, what's bringing them into the bait to sit and eat, right? And so that particular study was looking at, regardless if they ate or they did not eat, would they still die? And you saw that the vast majority of them would go ahead and perish. And in the end, there's only a 3% difference in death rate. So a lot of this comes from the perception of putting baits side by side. And then technicians just, like, you know, maybe sitting it, letting it sit there and wait 10 or 15 minutes and see how many roaches come up to it. And so it's just, it's a, you know, if you give them choices, maybe they might choose X product because it's kind of like rodents. Okay, it's very similar to what they have available, so they're used to it, so they have a flavor for it. And but if you give them only one option, maybe they still go to that particular bait and consume a lot of it, whereas you wouldn't know. You know, we did a weird study where we sprayed Phantom on top of alpine roach bait, and you know, we were just trying to prove that it was not repellent, and we ended up finding out they ate more of it, which is incredibly bizarre. I mean, they ate like 5x or something like that. I can't remember what the exact number was. So it was really strange. But yeah, I mean, I think a perception is that one of them, it might be better over the other based off of certain situations. Whereas based on our mortality numbers, I've not seen that significant of a difference between the two. You know, there might be minor differences in strains, but I've not seen anything substantial between the two.
Great.
Thanks, long-winded Jason. Answer for that one, but
no, that's
quite a big question.
Yeah. Yeah. I know, you know, I'm actually product manager for that product and see this question crop up from time to time. Jason did a better job of answering it specifically from a technical perspective than I could have. So thanks for that. I did see our very own Sylvia Kenmuir dropped in the Q&A that the spider eye chart was a t-shirt that she bought. So if you can reach out to Sylvia, that would she can help point you in the direction of procuring one of those spider eye charts. All right. That is all I'm seeing, Jason. Any closing remarks on your side?
Not for me.
All right. Well, again, thank you everyone for your time and your patience today, particularly at the beginning. Hope you found it worthwhile. And thank you, Dr. Jason, for taking us through a compendium of occasional invaders, including the recently problematic spotted lanternfly. So hope everyone has a fantastic rest of your afternoon. Be sure to reach out to your distributor to take advantage of BSF's fall promo through the end of October, and have a fantastic week. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you all.